is Rocky Forest reporting for the news. Something very astounding has happened. The people who were on the other side of this door behind me have been completely changed. You might hear some noise behind me because they've all poured out of this place and are out on the streets talking about Jesus. There was a huge sound of a big wind in the room where they were, and then what looked like tongues of fire came, and suddenly they were talking in languages that no one, they did never learn, but other people knew. And so it's just complete chaos here. I'm going to have to go find some people to talk to, but see you in worship.
Good morning. Welcome to Pentecost. Our call to worship is printed. I invite you to respond with a bold print. The Lord be with you. The grace of God has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Sing to God, sing praise to him. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. We're going to join together in singing Holy Spirit, Truth Divine. Let us pray. God of grace, we thank you that you have sent your Son among us. We thank you that he promised the Holy Spirit, and that on this Pentecost day we can celebrate the Holy Spirit coming in power. We rejoice, for the Spirit has come to be with us, to strengthen us, and we say thank you. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our prayer of confession is printed. Let's pray this together in unison. Come, Holy Spirit, rain upon our dry and dusty lives. Wash away our sin and heal our wounded spirits. Kindle within us the fire of your love to burn away our apathy. With your warmth, bend our rigidity and guide our wandering feet. Amen. Hear the good news. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far God has removed our sins from us. Let's believe the good news that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven, transformed to begin again as the followers of Jesus Christ.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes. Darkest waters and deepest pain, I wouldn't trade it for anything. 'Cause my brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. Now I'm standing in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness. And I'm not who I was before. No, I don't have to fear anymore. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And with my life I'll tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful. I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. Holy Spirit, living breath of God, breathe new life into my willing soul. Let the presence of the risen Lord come, renew my heart and make me whole. Cause your word to come alive in me, give me faith for what I cannot see. Give me passion for your purity. Holy Spirit, breathe new life in me. Holy Spirit, come abide within. May your joy be seen in all I do. Cover every sin in each thought and deed and attitude. show your power once again on earth. Cause your church to hunger for your ways. Let the fragrance of our prayers arise. Lead us on the road of sacrifice. In unity, the face of Christ may be clear for all the world to see.
So, do you notice anything different in the sanctuary today? Yes. And the balloons are what color? I know it's boring.
Red.
And all the banners are what color? Red. Now, let's talk about this banner. What do you see in the banner over here behind the piano? What do you see in that banner?
Flames.
Think that's rain?
Flames.
You're right. That's flames. So, and what, I can't see very well. What do you see in the banner over here on this side?
A bird.
A bird. What kind of bird do you think that is? Anyone want to guess what kind? That's this bird. You're right. Same as bird. What bird, kind of bird, do you think that is? Do you want some help from them? What kind of bird is it? A dove. The dove of the Holy Spirit. So Pentecost, which is what today is the day that we remember the Holy Spirit came in power and the church was born. And the Holy Spirit also came with flames. And so the red reminds us of the flames of the Holy Spirit that came on the disciples and the church was born. And so I'm wearing a red tie. We've got red everywhere, red balloons. We had red streamers coming out of the balcony. We even had red headbands. Way to go. Like that a lot. So we had red to remind us it is Pentecost. This is a day of celebration. And what's a celebration without helium balloons, right? You can't have a party without helium balloons. So today we remember that the church, this is the church's birthday, and we're having a party. Let's pray. Lord God, on this Pentecost Sunday, we say thank you for the church, for its birthday. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before our scripture readings, let us pray. God of grace, open our ears to hear from you. Speak to us your truth, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture reading comes from Acts chapter 2, reading verses 1 to 21, and then skipping down to the end of the chapter. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. At the sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my slaves, both men and women, in those days I'll pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And dropping down to verse 43, awe came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. Here ends our scripture reading for this morning. Yesterday afternoon at Knox College, I was asked if I was going to be preaching today. And I said, it's Pentecost. How can I not preach on Pentecost? This is a great day to be preaching on. But I have to confess that in the life of the church, Pentecost has a sort of strange history, strange life for us. See, where we started this text, where the text starts, feels so over the top, so strange. The rushing wind, the tongues of fire speaking languages they've never learned, feels so remote and different and weird. But the text ends, where we did, with stuff that feels so normal. Communion, prayer. So how does it go together? Is one the Holy Spirit and one and the other not? No, they're both the Holy Spirit. So I think we need to go back and walk our way through what's happening on this day, happened on that day. So some context. 10 days ago, Ascension Day, Jesus had gone back to heaven to sit at the right hand of God the Father. And he had told the disciples, go back to Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Holy Spirit. And they did. And 10 days passed. 10 days is a long time if you're waiting for something that you don't really know what it is, but you've just been told to wait, and they wait. And suddenly then, on Pentecost Sunday morning, which is a Jewish high holiday, the room where they are, the same room where they had gathered to celebrate the Lord's Supper, that same room is suddenly filled with sound like a rushing wind. And what looks like tongues of fire comes down on every one of them who are gathered there. And suddenly they can speak in languages they have never learned. And they burst out of that room and chaos ensues. Because people hear the good news spoken to them in their own mother tongue, coming to them, speaking to them, challenging them. Let's think about that for a moment. This peace that the good news, the God's word, comes for people of every language group, is a significant piece of what the church has believed and lived into ever since that moment. The church has spent many resources of people and money and other resources in translating the Bible into languages of people around the world so they can hear the good news, read the good news in their own mother tongue. Imagine what it would be like if we had no Bibles in English, which I realize is probably very difficult for us to imagine. If there are no Bibles in English and we had to learn another language in order to read the Bible. That's a huge hurdle, is it not? And it gives some sense that maybe God doesn't talk our language, just talks other people's languages. In 2017, Debbie and I had the privilege of traveling to Taiwan for the dedication of the Nudrukai Bible. The Nudrukai are an indigenous people group who live in Taiwan, and we were there to celebrate that they have the Bible in their own language for the first time. The day after the celebration, we spent that night at a motel owned by one of the elders of the Nudrukai Church, and he had not been at the celebration. And the person who was being our guide around the island of Taiwan, Paul McLean, said to the owner of the hotel, "Do you have your own Bible? Your own Nudrukai Bible was dedicated yesterday." And the man said, "No." So Paul had an extra one and gave it to the man. And then Paul said to the man, "Could you read from the Bible in your own language?" And the man turned to Psalm 80 and began to read in Nudrukai. And his face lit up. He was reading the Word of God in his language. It was transformative, profoundly moving. We had that experience as well when we visited another pastor and he was asked to read in his own language. His eyes lit up as he read the Word of God in his language. His language. The Word of God has come to us in our tongue, in our language. Now, that list of countries that goes by us so fast, we sometimes don't pay any attention because we don't know the history and the geography of that part of the world. But the list of names starts with the Parthians, the Medes, and the Elamites. And we say to ourselves, well, who cares? What we should, in fact, be saying is, what? At the time of the early church, the time these events took place, which is around 30 AD, there hadn't been a Parthian in the world in about 1,000 years. The Medes were just a distant past memory, as were the Elamites. But all three of those groups had been people who had invaded or held captive the Jews. And so what's being said here is the Holy Spirit has come to bring reconciliation and hope, to break down those walls of division of ethnicity, not just on language, but also of bitter hatred, of war, of all of those difficulties. Even those who have been captured by other peoples are invited still to hear the Word of God in their language, in their mother tongue, brought back across the lines of ethnic division. Well, the chaos continues, the good news is preached, and finally people want to know, what on earth does this mean? What on earth is going on here? And Peter, the Apostle Peter, the one who denied Jesus, the one who had no bravery, suddenly stands up and says, "I'll tell you what's going on." Bold, brash, now courageous Peter speaks. And he turns to the book of Joel and quotes from it. Quotes a section about the coming of the Holy Spirit, the promise of the Father, and the Holy Spirit coming. But it's very interesting who it is that the Holy Spirit comes to in this passage. Men and women. Both hear the good news. Both are called. There is no division. All are called, men and women. Young and old also hear the good news, hear and are called by the Spirit, called to be witnesses to the Spirit. Now, we may not say it out loud, or maybe we do, I don't know. But we sometimes may think in our heads, they're too young. Or we may have heard people say around us, they're too old. Let's look at the Bible for a moment. Josiah became king, used by God, at the age of 12. I think that's young. Moses doesn't begin to do his work for God until he's 80. Now, I realize there'll be people in the room who'll tell me that 80 is not old. But 80 to begin, I think we'd all agree that's a little advanced in age, to be starting. young and old, doesn't matter. He says, all who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. He goes on, and we skip this part in the reading. He goes on to explain to the people that they need to turn to Jesus. They need to become followers of Jesus, for he is the one who can save them. He is the one who can save them from their sins. And he invites them to become followers of Jesus. And 3,000 people join the church that day. So they went from 120 to 3,000 in one afternoon. Now, what are you going to do with all these people? Can we have this slide, please? So suddenly, how are you going to now work with this group of 3,000 plus? What's going to happen? How are you going to train them? How are they going to learn, become the church that has been born on this day? Acts 2:42 says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to breaking of bread, and to the prayers. We say, well, that's pretty obvious. Let's just unpack those for a moment. Devoted to the apostles' teaching. This process of learning, of growing, of hearing the word, of reading the word, of living into the word is an ongoing process of continually growing and learning. One of the greatest basketball players of all time was Michael Jordan. And Michael Jordan was the first to arrive at practice and the last to leave, although he was incredibly gifted as an athlete. He spent hours simply shooting the basketball so that his muscles knew exactly how much effort to give at different points on the floor. He practiced. He learned. And we too are invited to bathe ourselves, immerse ourselves, exercise our muscle memory of learning the word, of living this scripture, of bringing it deep into our lives. Fellowship. I have nothing against coffee after church, but that's not what they meant by fellowship. Fellowship was much deeper than that. Fellowship was a commitment to one another, gathering together, listening to one another, being engaged with one another, connected deeply. Breaking of bread is communion. It's celebrating and remembering that Christ died for us and rose again and that we have been transformed and that this meal takes that from being memory to something that we live out and act, that becomes a part of who we are, a habit in our lives that shapes us. And prayer? Prayer forms us as people, as individuals, but also as a community. For our prayers are not just for ourselves, but for the community at large. We join a community around the world in prayer, and we are connected to them in that way. And that verse, Acts 2:42, is well known, and these are four markers. Acts 2:43 says, and signs and wonders were done among them. So we say signs and wonders. So now we're ready, right? We're ready for some big miracle, some massive, huge change. Something big is going to happen. No, signs and wonders, they've been promised to us. And the sign and wonder that we are given is they shared with one another, particularly those who were in need. And we say, huh? How is that a sign or wonder? But let's wait for a moment. Isn't it part of the human condition to say, what's mine is mine, and you don't get it? Deeply rooted. Deeply, deeply rooted. The coming of the Holy Spirit changed people who were part of the church, that they sold what they had and gave to those who were in need. They shared generously with people who didn't have. They gave away on behalf of others. I think it's not a mistake that Luke, having said signs and wonders were performed, immediately tells us about this deep commitment to sharing with those who were in need within the body of Christ. For that level of commitment, that sign is a sign of God being at work in the world. A handful of people manage to escape from North Korea, and they have to head north because you can't go south. They head north into China. They cross the border out of North Korea with nothing. But the vast majority of them know this truth. Look for a building with a cross on it, because they will help you. Isn't that a powerful witness? That people in a non-Christian country like North Korea, where to be a Christian can get you thrown into prison, know that if you are in trouble, the place to go is church. Wouldn't you like to have a reputation like that? Wouldn't that be cool? The early church had that reputation, formed by the Holy Spirit, shaped in that way, caused and transformed in those ways. The Holy Spirit has come. We've been born as the church. And we are invited to live out the marks of the church at Pentecost, devoted to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to breaking of bread, to prayers, and to sharing with those who are in need. Signs of what it means for the Holy Spirit to be alive in us. For the good news has come to us in our language. Men, women, young, old, has come for all of us, to all of us, to transform and shape us. Thanks be to God for the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God for Pentecost. Amen. Let us pray. God of grace, we thank you for the coming of the Holy Spirit. Coming in power and wind and flame on the day of Pentecost. And that your good news, your word, was heard by people of every tribe and language who had gathered in their mother tongue. We thank you that the good news still goes out in the native language of each. We thank you for the work of missionaries around the world to translate the Bible in the languages of peoples. And for the good news, the joy that is ours when we can read the word in our own mother tongue. We thank you for that the Holy Spirit has come to men and women, young and old, people of every tribe and ethnicity. We say thank you. Shape us as your people as we read your word and learn from the apostles' teaching. As we fellowship with one another, as we break bread in communion, as we pray, as we share with those in need. Shape us, form us by these practices, we pray. We come praying for our world. We pray for peace to arrive in Ukraine. We have prayed for it for many days, many months. Bring peace, we pray. We pray about the situation in Sudan. We pray that you would bring hope in the midst of that tragedy, that the warring sides would seek peace above war and humility above ego. We pray for those who fight forest fires in Alberta, that you would give them strength and perseverance. We remember those who are sick. We pray for those who grieve. And in the silence, we bring to you our thanksgivings and our requests, knowing that you hear us. We pray all of these things in the strong name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let's join together in singing, O Breath of Life, Come Sweeping Through Us. The disciples on the day of Pentecost were in the same room as they had been when they celebrated the Last Supper, the Lord's Supper, with Jesus the night before he was betrayed. Same place, same room. But suddenly, the way they celebrated that meal would have been transformed. Not only was Christ risen from the dead, something experienced on Easter Sunday, not only was he seated at the right hand of God the Father, but with the coming of the Holy Spirit, that power was in their lives to live out this good news. And so we come to this table on this Pentecost Sunday to rejoice that the Holy Spirit has come to live in us, to shape us and form us as God's people, as followers of Jesus Christ, as people gifted by the Holy Spirit. He invites us, if we've been here before or haven't been here for a long time, to come and to eat and to drink and to celebrate with him. Let's pray. You'll see the opening parts of the great prayer printed. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. God of grace, we do give you thanks and praise, for you created all things in the beginning of time. In the fullness of time, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to live among us, full of grace and truth. He healed the sick and was a friend of sinners. He showed us the path of following you and died and rose again that we might live, having been transformed from our sin. But you did not leave us alone. When the time was right, you sent the Holy Spirit in power, who came upon the disciples as wind and flame and tongues. And you still do that now, filling us, and we rejoice in the ways that you have filled us with your grace and love, gifting us, calling us, forming and shaping us as your people. Thank you. As we eat this bread and drink this cup, remind us that you live in us by the power of the Spirit. And may we be shaped as your people in this act. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and when he had broken it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this remembering me." As the meal was ending, he took the cup. He said, "This cup is a sign of the new covenant, the new relationship between God and human beings. Every time you drink of it, do so remembering me and my love for you." These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So if you would take your handy-dandy communion cup and pull off the cellophane on the top, you'll then get the wafer. And if I just hold on to the wafer for a moment as we reflect on the fact of Christ's death, resurrection, and the gift of the Holy Spirit for us. This is the bread of life. Eat with joy. I should pull off the aluminum foil from the cup. This is the cup of salvation. Drink in celebration. Let us pray. Lord God, you have so long loved us, so deeply saved us, so powerfully redeemed us. Cause us, shaped by your love and grace and the power of the Spirit, to live for you with our lives. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. There are some announcements to bring to your attention. First, we welcome all those who worship with us. It's good to get together to celebrate God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And then this coming Sunday, we move to one worship service at 10 o'clock, and we'll stay with one worship service at 10 o'clock until September the 3rd. And there is an insert in your bulletin that outlines the mixture of traditional and contemporary through that time. There are just a couple of other announcements I want to highlight for you. I talked about the insert of the summer schedule. I do want to highlight that there are a couple other things on there, the medieval festival, the two camps, the sports camp and the VBS, and new this year, we are doing two mini VBSs in parks in town. And so just want to let you know about that and to keep those in your prayers. I will be away for basically the month of June, and Ed Charlton of Arthur Congregation will be covering if there are pastoral needs, crisis pastoral needs, and he can be reached either by contacting your elder or through the church office.
As you all know, our esteemed pastor received yesterday a degree for Doctor of Divinity from Knox College at the University of Toronto. And a great honor. And Peter is kind of a behind-the-scenes guy, even though he's at the front every Sunday. And so we are going to try, right, Jim, to show you the clip of the presentation that was made at Knox yesterday. And I think it's we need to hear what Peter's been up to for a number of years. And I will also add, and that was pointed out yesterday, that no ministry happens without the support, the full support of the family. And so, Debbie, you're all part of this also. So we're going to first to watch the clip that was from yesterday afternoon. And then there's a presentation.
Principal Van Eck, Director Diaz, Vice Provost McCann, it is my privilege to present the Reverend Peter Bush for the degree Doctor of Divinity, honoris causa. Knox College confers the honorary Doctor of Divinity degree on those who have made distinguished contributions in at least two of six areas of service. Our candidate today has met that criteria for all six. This is extraordinary and impossible to capture in the few words of this presentation. However, let me try. The son of missionaries, Peter grew up between the Middle East and Canada. He studied history at Queen's University and graduated with a BA and MA. Sensing a call to serve the church and to study theology and church history, Peter completed a Master of Theological Studies at what was then Ontario Theological Seminary, now Tyndale University and Seminary, followed by Master of Divinity Studies here at Knox College, graduating in 1989. For over 30 years, Peter has been a faithful and creative congregational minister in remote, small town, and urban churches. Flin Flon, Manitoba, Mitchell, Ontario, Winnipeg, Manitoba, and now in Fergus, Ontario. In each place, Peter has thought deeply about the meaning of the gospel with his people as he preached and taught. He has lived among them as a caring pastor, an authentic follower of Jesus Christ, and he has led them courageously in worship and witness in their community. Beyond his core commitment as minister of word and sacraments in local congregations, Peter has also given creative leadership at all levels of the church's life. For 30 years, Peter served as editor of Presbyterian History and wrote many of its feature articles. He is a gifted historian who has documented Presbyterian stories across Canada, including important research on the Presbyterian Church in Canada's involvement in residential schools, which has contributed to the work of truth and reconciliation. One of the nominators said this: "His gifts as an historian are special to the denomination. Peter has the ability to compose a story about someone, and the story becomes a history lesson that we will cherish for years to come." In addition to his work with the Committee on History, Peter has served on the Pension and Benefits Board and the Church Doctrine Committee. He is currently the convener of the Trustee Board and co-chair of the Special Listening Committee in response to the petitions of the Hong Kong Presbyteries. Peter has chaired and organized national conferences, including a 2002 gathering on the history and practice of evangelism within the Presbyterian Church, and a 2017 conference on the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. In 2017, Peter was elected as moderator of the 143rd General Assembly, the highest office in the Presbyterian Church in Canada. In his role as moderator, he wrote and published an open letter of repentance to the LGBTQI+ community for the church's failure to be a safe and welcoming space. He is a strong advocate for an intercultural and inclusive church. One nominator said that Peter embodies the truth that all good theology begins in prayer. His prayers on public issues, in particular spread through a series of social media, have been a great source of prophetic insight and pastoral comfort. As a church historian and a student of congregations and missions, he has written three books: Western Challenge, The Presbyterian Church in Canada on the Prairies and the North, 1885 to 1925, In Dying We Are Born, and Where 20 or 30 Are Gathered, co-authored with the Reverend Dr. Christine O'Reilly. Knox College confers three doctoral degrees: a professional doctor of ministry, an academic doctor of philosophy and theological studies, and the honorary doctor of divinity. As the author of numerous articles and books, academic, professional, and popular, Peter could have qualified for any of Knox's doctoral degrees had he wished to. But he's chosen to serve the church on the ground in the community for the sake of the gospel and the glory of God. Those who know Peter or have seen him in action know that he cares deeply and passionately about people, about the gospel, about justice, about the flourishing of the church. He cares and he works tirelessly. He is indefatigable, sometimes impatient when the church lags in doing something he sees as so obvious. Peter has been married to Debbie Sutherland Bush for 34 years, and together they have one son, Nathan. Peter would be the first to admit that the work that has been accomplished in ministry over these years has been done together in partnership. For his contribution to pastoral ministry, to scholarly work in the service of the church and academy, to the Presbyterian Church at all its levels, and to the community, Peter has done all this with energy and faith. For all these reasons, President Van Eck, I present the Reverend Peter Bush, that you may confer on him the degree Doctor of Divinity Honoris Causa.
Authority of the Governing Board of Knox College and the University of Toronto, you are hereby admitted to the degree Doctoris Divinitatis Honoris Causa.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And it is, there's the... on the front there it says,
the Tree of Wisdom.
Yes, this represents the Tree of Wisdom. And there's, that's a bracket to hang it on. So I think we are all very grateful to have Peter and Debbie among us and leading us. And let's just...
You will notice that there was no opportunity for me to say anything at that point, which is standard. That's not the practice usually for the DD recipient. But I did have notes that I had taken with me just in case. Don't worry, I'm not going to give them all, but I do want to say this. I want to say two things, in fact. Because my parents will watch this at some point, I did want to give a shout out to them, and so I will do that now to thank them for all that they have done and their support and encouragement. But I also was going to say yesterday, and I say it again today, that this is not my DD alone. This is Debbie's DD as well. All right. Let us give to God, who has been so gracious and generous to us, our tithes and offerings will now be received. Let us pray. God of grace, take these gifts that we return to you. Use them that all the world might know your love and grace shown to us by the power of your Holy Spirit. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's join together and sing Spirit, Spirit of Gentleness.
Spirit.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit, be now and forevermore. Amen.